So let's go ahead and take a look at an example of how we can evaluate or determine continuity of just a function, okay, no longer having a graph. And usually when we're trying to determine continuity, we're most likely working with piecewise functions, because usually those are the ones that have a hole or a jump in them, because we have all these different equations that we're trying to graph, and they may or may not match up when we start looking at some of these domain values. So for continuity, again, we gotta check that holy trinity. Does the point exist? Does the limit exist? And do they match? So taking a look at number 4, we have 3 pieces, and we specifically want to check the continuity at -2. And hopefully it kind of makes sense that we're checking that value, because that's part of the domain or the constraint section of this piecewise function. So we have the first section stopping at the x value of -2, the second piece is only found at the x value of -2, and the third piece begins at the x value of -2. So we have these 3 equations that involve something dealing with the x value of -2. We just want to make sure that they all match up. So let's go ahead and check out our first criteria. Does the point exist? So if we were to substitute in -2 into this function, we're going to check out the constraint section to see which equation would qualify. And notice how if we want to plug in -2, that means we want to actually equal the value. So that satisfies our second equation. So if we plug in -2, we'll get -6 + 2, which would be -4. So we plug in a number, we get out a number, that means our point exists. So we satisfy the first of our 3 criteria. Let's check out the limit though. So we want to check out as we approach -2 from the left, as we approach -2 from the right, and what do those tell us about the overall limit at -2. So for a piecewise function, of the 3 pieces, we want to pick the one that shows up for x values smaller than -2, looking at the constraint that would satisfy the first equation. So always do direct substitution first. If we plug in -2, we'll get the square root of 4, which is 2, times -2, we get -4. Now to check out the right-handed side, look at the constraints to see which equation would fit. And looks like x values bigger than -2 would be the third equation. So let's go ahead and directly substitute in -2. So we'll have e to the -2, and then cosine of -2 pi, that just means we're traveling backwards on the unit circle, a full rotation. So we're basically back to where we started, and the cosine value of that beginning spot is 1. Now the left-hand side is -4, clearly the right-hand side is not -4, so that's telling us the overall limit doesn't exist. Now the overall limit must exist, okay, that's part of the criteria for continuity, so the fact that we just go ahead and get that doesn't exist result tells us that we are not continuous at this x value of -2. So we can say f of x is not continuous at x equals -2. If we actually try to think about what this would look like graphically, we clearly have a hole, and that's happening at the x value or the y value of -4. And notice how the left-hand side meets up with that value. So the left-hand side has that hole, whereas the right-hand side does not. It has something other than -4, and if we actually were to calculate it out, it would be bigger than -4, so the right-hand side has that open circle coming in from the right. So this is clearly a jump, where the left and the right sides do not meet. Taking a look at number 5, we're going to test the continuity at x equals pi, because notice how based on the constraints or the domains, that's where one equation ends and the next one begins. So we want to make sure that they end and begin at that same spot. Everything's connected. Our first criteria is seeing if a point actually exists. So if we were to plug in pi, looking at the constraints, we would use the second equation because we can equal pi. So we'll have e to the pi, and then tangent of 3π/4, that's not a spot on the unit circle that you definitely have to know, so you may have to reference a unit circle to help you out with that, but the tangent value at that radian location is -1. So we clearly get a point, we get a value, and the point exists. Let's go ahead and check out the limit. So as we approach pi from the left and then the right, what does that tell us about the overall limit at pi? So looking at the constraints, values smaller to the left of pi would satisfy the first domain, so we would use the first equation. And direct substitution, we would have e to the pi times cosine of pi, which is negative 1. So we have negative e to the pi. So far they're starting to match, and that's good, okay, but notice how that was the case previously, but the other limit, or the right side limit, didn't match. So let's see what happens here. The right hand side of pi would be the second equation. So we'll go ahead and do direct substitution there. And we actually already did this when we found the point value in number one. So it's going to have the same result. Notice how left hand side and right hand side have the same value. So the overall limit is negative e to the pi. So we have a point, we have a limit. The third piece is that they have to match. And clearly the point value equals the limit value. So we can say g of pi equals the limit as we approach pi. So therefore g of x is continuous at the x location of pi.